Chuck Harder. You help me survive this thing called life.
Hi, everybody. Well, there is a long-distance failure in many parts of the United States right now. We do not know why. But I have been trying to call a friend of mine in California since this morning. No luck. I called a friend of mine at the phone company. He couldn't get through. I called the operator. Do you remember the day that you could dial O for operator and you actually got an operator? Now you got to dial OO. Did you know that? So I dialed OO and got an operator. I asked the operator to try the number, and the operator said, now you're going to have to pay for this call. And I said, well, if you can get through, I'll pay for it. Beep, 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 beep. I wonder what it is. Maybe it's the heat, huh? But it's all over the United States. There are several different parts of the U.S. of A. that you just can't get through to. I called earlier today, before I started on the air today, I said to the folks at the radio network, I said, I have a feeling we're going to have problems today, guys, because of the fact I called the area codes where some of the guests were and just got a beeping signal. Beep, 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 beep. And sure enough, that's what's happening. But we're going to keep trying. And while we do that, I'll tell you a little bit about Paul Krugman. If you have availability to the Internet, you can go to the New York Times, which is obviously the New York Times newspaper. And Paul Krugman writes a op-ed column about twice a week for the New York Times. Paul used to be the consummate free trader. He thought that globalism and free trade was just wonderful. And of course, back when I was fighting it in 1992, 1993, he and others like him called me every name in the book. I was bashing big business. I was a nativist. I was a isolationist. Oh, dear God, I mean, they pinned every horrible name on me that they could think of. And back then, as you know, they said that there would never be a trade deficit. No trade deficit. Do you remember Lee Iacocca and his ads on TV? Little old Mexico? You mean you're afraid of little old Mexico? Remember that? Well, what Lee Iacocca is not telling you in his new ads today about Chrysler is that many, many, many of their vehicles are made totally in Mexico. One of their most popular is the Chrysler PT Cruiser, totally made in Mexico. Some of their pickup trucks, totally made in Mexico. Are you afraid of little old Mexico? Remember those? Remember those ads? I'd like to rub his nose in it. But then again, Mr. Iacocca is very, very rich, and I'm not. So what has happened to the United States of America is that we have allowed big money, as I told you last hour, big money always wins. Always. Big money bought NAFTA. Big money bought GATT. Big money is buying CAFTA, the Central America Free Trade Agreement. It'll pass. It'll pass in the middle of the night, probably on 3 o'clock on a Saturday or a Sunday morning. It'll pass because of the fact Congress is bought and paid for by big money. That's who does it. That's who pays for it. The big money, the big fat cats. And I think Peter G. Peterson, who has got a new book out called Running on Empty, is probably right when he was on this broadcast about a year ago. And he believed back then there was a 75% chance of a long and protracted depression or recession. either the D or the R word. He wasn't sure which. And today we see that gasoline prices are now at $60 a barrel. Now, stop and think for a minute. Why is the oil $60 a barrel? Think about that for a minute. Is it because there's a terrible shortage of oil? Is that why? Or is it because of the fact that the value of the United States dollar is about one half of what it used to be a year or two ago? Now let's take a look at the housing bubble. It wasn't too long ago that you could buy a pretty nice house just about anywhere in the United States in the area of about $80,000, which was a lot of money. Today, they're talking $300,000-$400,000 for the same house. So, what is the value of the American dollar? Think about it. Chuck Carter for the people.
Say, do you or a member of your family suffer from acne? Do you take prescription drugs and get little or no relief? Is your skin always dry and itching and peeling due to the side effects of chemicals and drugs? Do you have trouble looking in the mirror and being happy with what you see? Do you avoid going out in the world due to your acne? Are you spending ridiculous amounts of money with little or no results? Well, you may find relief. Relief is available to most sufferers online at healthstarproducts.com. It's guaranteed, or you get your money back, and you've got 90 days to decide. Look it up for yourself online at HealthStar Products, H-E-A-L-T-H, healthstarproducts.com. Go to www.healthstarproducts.com and find out about the acne program. Find out if it works for you or a member of your family. If it doesn't, you get your money back. I've been reading online about a drug-free home treatment program that suggests you can be asthma-free. It's a program designed by an ex-asthmatic who claims she cured her own asthma. It's based on a little-known but astounding clinical trial at a major hospital. What would you give to be free of asthma, asthma symptoms, and sinus and allergy symptoms, to breathe easily, freely, naturally, in a relaxed way? This drug-free method, proven by clinical trials, is guaranteed, or you get your money back, and you have 90 days to decide. Get to a computer now and go to HealthStarProducts.com. That's www.HealthStarProducts.com. Read about the asthma program, and if it doesn't do what it says it'll do for you, you get your money back, and you've got 90 days to decide. Go to HealthStarProducts.com.
Years ago, a fan of mine out in California cut a song called We Must Take America Back, and I guess that's probably what we really, really need to do, huh? Nathan Leslie is on the line with us. Nathan, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Welcome, and thank you for joining us early.
Well, thank you.
Okay. Now, you're an author of a book that is essentially about what?
It's about secondhand culture, about buying and selling and living on what the rest of America throws away. It begins with the high-end culture of auctions and works its way down through yard sales and flea markets and all the way to how to pick up good stuff off the curb during on Big Trash Day. I like to think of it as sort of an anti-American sort of commercialism book, a book that tries to reunite us with our sort of essential American marketplace.
Once upon a time, years ago, when I was unemployed, and my unemployment benefits had run out. I had a little Honda car, and I used to go about two blocks ahead of the trash truck. And I would find the most unusual things waiting for the trash truck to pick up. Everything from beautiful floor lamps, table lamps, furniture, you name it. And I used to put it in my little van. And then I would go out to the flea market on the weekend and turn the stuff into about $300-$400.
Mm-hmm. You can do that. A lot of times things can be consigned in auctions, and you can make money on that. In fact, I was just at an auction preview just before I got on the phone here, and I have two things that are for sale at this particular auction, both of which I picked out of the trash in Saratoga Springs, New York, near where I live.
Really?
Mm-hmm. One is an oak desk chair, very nice oak swivel desk chair, and the other is a pre-World War II world globe, which,
wow,
as you can imagine, shows a quite different world than the one you would look at today if you saw a globe. I was actually tempted to keep that, but I thought, if you start saving and collecting everything that you can find secondhand, that way lies madness. You know, you have to let some of it go in order to let some of it, the stuff you can really use, into your life. So they'll be selling that tonight, and it'll be interesting to see just what kind of free money they'll have for me.
What kind of success have you had in the past?
Well, mostly what I've done for myself has been to furnish my home and my wardrobe, and a large portion of my wife and kids' wardrobes and so on, almost entirely secondhand. I've done this over the years. Every stick of furniture I have, except for mattresses and box springs that we have been acquired secondhand, either through yard sales or through trash picking. Every lamp I have, I rarely buy anything new except for flashlight batteries. And I find that there's a very rewarding way to live. It's a way that re-involves you in, as I say, sort of the American marketplace. I know the people that I buy things from. It's not faceless like when you go to the big box stores like Walmart or Target, where the same clerk twice. I know the people who I get to know them. I have friends in the trade who call me when they get a hold of something that they know I might need. It's rewarding on many levels, not just on the level of the pocketbook.
Now, in the past, one of the sicknesses that I've had in the past is pocket watches.
Mm-hmm.
American-made pocket watches, and I have a rather nice collection.
Mm.
And I found many of them by going to yard sales.
Absolutely.
And I would see, you know, these pocket watches laying there with a price of $3 or $2 or $1. And I'm talking about pretty nice stuff, Waltham, Elgin's, you name it.
Mm-hmm.
And, and some of them were running.
Sure.
And I immediately picked them up and bought them and found that they had a wholesale value in the area of $80, $90.
Mm-hmm.
But most people just, do they go to yard sales? Are yard sales passe, or is this, of course, it depends where you go to the yard sales. I mean, if you go to yard sales in rural America, you're probably not going to get really, really beautiful stuff because of the fact that folks are pretty poor. But what people used to do was to go to farm sales.
Yes.
All right. Let me do a two-minute break. When we come back, tell us what a farm sale is. We'll be right back with our friend Nat and Leslie right after this.
Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom, one of the best shows television ever offered. Now you can travel again with Marlon Perkins to the farthest reaches of the globe and study wild animals in their natural habitats. The Emmy Award-winning Wild Kingdom, now available on DVD. Order online at RetroTelevision.com and get 24 episodes for $29.99. You'll see gorillas, elephants, giraffes, zebras, hippos, and more. Also memorable, 3 episodes featuring legendary primate researcher Diana Fossey from Gorillas in the Mist. 20 episodes of Wild Kingdom on DVD for $29.99. Go to RetroTelevision.com, or if you forget, log on to www.talkstarradio.com and check out our video store. Save $10 on Wild Kingdom now at RetroTelevision.com. You know what Shakespeare said to do with all the lawyers? Well, okay, that might be tempting, but a better idea might be to survive lawyers. When you need a do-it-yourself legal form of any kind, and we're talking about over 10,000 different kinds of legal forms here, go to www.chuckcartershow.com. Right there on the homepage, you'll find the link for over 10,000 legal forms. These forms are designed to help protect your rights and save you time and money. Why pay more elsewhere for the same type of legal forms? Here are over 10,000 forms prepared by attorneys and offered with a no-risk, 100% money-back guarantee. So when you need legal forms of any kind, go to www.chuckcartershow.com. That's chuckcartershow.com. There's no cost to check it out. Go to www.chuckcartershow.com, where you can link up with over 10,000 legal forms online.
Right, Nath and Leslie with us, and the book is that might be useful, Exploring America's Secondhand Culture. And I guess a lot of people don't understand what a farm sale is. Tell us what that is.
Well, I assume what you mean from a farm sale. Do you mean a farm auction or an actual sale?
Well, very often when somebody who owns a farm dies, they do it in two portions.
Okay.
First of all, they auction off everything that is in the house.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that, they auction off the house and the land.
Right. Well, the auctioning off of the contents of the house or basically what is an estate auction was very common in rural areas. It's a great way to get a wide variety of household goods that you might need that are in great shape because they were still being used, obviously, when the person passed on. But it's also a great way to find, like you cited, those old pocket watches, or the thing that might be the thing that you want to collect, the thing that you enjoy having. I've collected a number of things over the years. I used to collect knives. I used to collect old bottles. And I found that, unlike some collectors, I run out of steam after a while, and I only like just a handful of examples or something. But some people are very, very fascinated with particular items. Farm sales are good because I find because of the barns. America's barns are full of great things that people have saved over the years and hoarded, and when they're finally brought out in a sale like that into the light of day, some of the oddest and most unusual things can be seen crossing an auction block. I've often said that America's farms and the barns that are full of stuff is kind of the repository of some of America's memories. So yeah, they're great sales, and estate sales in general are among the best way to find secondhand stuff for your personal use or for resale.
Now, a lot of people need to understand that the term estate sale should not scare you away.
Right.
Explain why.
Well, an estate sale just simply means that it is the estate or the worldly possessions of someone who has passed on. It doesn't mean that they had an estate, you know, with a big mansion or something. An estate can be quite a humble affair. So when you see estate sale, it just simply means that someone has died and the contents of their homes are being sold at reasonable prices with either as an auction or as a yard sale run as an estate sale. I get a lot of good stuff that way. I've picked up many, many useful things that kitchenwares, for example, are great things to get at estate sales because, you know, most people's kitchens are fully stocked with all the appliances that you might need and whatever, and you can pick these things up for pennies on the dollar. First-class four-slot toasters that might cost you $150 in, Bed Bath and Beyond, you're going to pick up for $3 or $4 in an estate sale. It's incredible that the amount of wealth that there is in America in secondhand goods and material possessions like that.
And most people really don't go, do they?
No, most people don't understand. They don't go. We have a general idea in this culture that somehow buying something secondhand is lessened. New is better. There's a whole generation that believes in a sort of, having something new is better than having something used. And I think that really runs contrary to what I see as the essential American character, what has often been called Yankee frugalness, or just the essential notion that we're not a wasteful culture at heart, that we are a culture of frugal reusers and people who don't waste things. It's only been within recent years, I think, that the throwaway culture has made yard sales a subculture instead of one of the primary ways that we exchange our goods and services.
I was mentioning to another guest earlier that everything that I have in my house that plugs into the wall is made in China. And I just got done throwing away another made-in-China electric can opener by Black & Decker because it failed. And so I bought another one. It'll probably last me for a year, and then I'll have to throw it away. So did I save any money by buying a brand-new Chinese can opener? I don't think so.
No. In fact, I just recently had to get a new lawnmower. If you look at a lawnmower with a Briggs & Stratton engine on it, you think, well, I've got a made-in-USA lawnmower. And, in fact, it's been made in China. It's been assembled in Taiwan and sent to the United States whole, even though it says Briggs & Stratton. It was once a gold medal U.S. company for small engines. I mean, you said small engines. That was the name that first came to your lips. Well, I needed a new lawnmower, and I went around to people I knew who repaired old lawnmowers. And they were willing to sell one to me for, $35, $40, all repaired, carburetor rebuilt, ready to go. And I asked them, I said, well, I could go to Walmart, and buy a new one for $90. Why should I buy one off you for $40? And they ran through the entire list of ways that a brand new lawnmower made in China that you could buy at Walmart is inferior, actually.
Hang on, and let's talk about so many ways that the new stuff is, pardon the expression, pure junk compared to stuff that was made to last. We'll be right back in just 3 minutes on TalkStar. Chuck Carter for the people.
This is news break. Discovery launched this morning, sending the first shuttle crew into space since the Columbia disaster in 2003. Despite earlier troubles with a fuel sensor that forced the scrub of the planned July 13th launch, morning's liftoff from Cape Canaveral was picture perfect. Now NASA intends to thoroughly analyze video footage from today's launch. Cameras mounted on Discovery may have captured a bit of debris falling from the external tank during liftoff. British police are gathering more potential evidence as they search for suspects. And
got the chance to take a look at this film and photography. We'll get back with you and tell you exactly what it was. I mean, if there was something there, these guys will find it.
Of course, it was a chunk of falling phone debris from the external tank that doomed the Columbia mission in 03. NASA spent the past 2 years working on ways to minimize debris impacts.
All right, we're talking to Nat and Leslie. What is the name of the book?
It's That Might Be Useful, Exploring America's Secondhand Culture.
That might be useful.
That might be useful, right.
All right, now, spend a minute and talk to us about the once upon a time, made in the USA, real Briggs & Stratton lawnmower that was maybe 5 years old, but had been totally repaired, totally updated for $35 versus the new one for $100. As a matter of fact, I was just at the store the other day, and they wanted $150 for them.
Oh, yes. Yeah. I mean, you know, you're doing good if you can get one for $100. Occasionally, you can get one for on sale for that. Well, among the so-called improvements to new lawnmowers are the little rod that you have to hold up in order to keep the engine running. If you let loose of it, for some reason, the engine cuts out. It's, of course, a safety thing because lawnmower companies were sued. People cut their hands off because they were would reach down near the blade and they claimed that there should be some sort of cutoff to prevent them from being that stupid. So they put these rods on. But there's a number of things that are connected to the carburetor. There's a little rubber. You ever notice a little rubber pump that you have to depress in order to prime the carburetor? Well, according to a friend of mine who repairs lawnmowers, those rubber things crack. And when they crack, there's no way to replace them because they're built right into the carburetor itself. There's no way to take the carburetor out to replace them. And so essentially, you get too much air in the carburetor, the carburetor won't work. Well, you think, I'll replace the carburetor. The carburetor is welded onto the side of the engine. And so the entire lawnmower will only last as long as that little rubber pump lasts. And, of course, you know, all you have to do is have that weather once in the heat or in the rain, and it's not going to last more than 2 years. Whereas the old Briggs and Stratton had the old-fashioned choke on it that was, you know, run with a cable, and the things are virtually indestructible. And those are the things that are keep getting repaired again and again and used again and again. And it's one way in which the second-hand culture will give you better merchandise for half the money what you'll spend on new.
But why is it? Help me understand this, if you would.
Mm-hmm.
Why is it that the media does not tell us how junky this stuff is that's coming in from China or other countries with famous names? So let me give you an example. I've got a coffee pot, you know, Mr. Coffee.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's made in China. And, you know, pardon the expression, but it's not very well made.
Right.
I got a Black & Decker can opener called a Grand Openings. Well, pardon the expression, but it's junk. You know, why is the media so silent on this? Why don't they explain, just like you and I do? You know, I don't know if you remember the story on Briggs & Stratton, but they used to be in Milwaukee, Ohio. I'm sorry, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, I believe.
Right.
And I believe they employed thousands and thousands of people in Milwaukee.
Mm-hmm.
And then they shut the plant and moved it offshore. I think they first went to Mexico. I'm not sure. I don't know where they went first. But they moved it offshore, just like Swingline Staples and all the other companies that have gone offshore. And the stuff that comes back, so much of it is just pure junk.
Yeah.
You know, there is a company in Chicago that makes fans called Lasko, L-A-S-K-O.
Right.
And they made the finest fans that I ever laid my eyes on. Well, today, I cannot find a Lasko fan that's made in the USA. They're all made in China.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
They're good for about one season. And then they just bind up and they're no good.
I think that part of what has been programmed into industry, global industry, is make something that won't last because then people have to buy it again and again and again. There's so much less competition now in new markets because, for instance, you mentioned Briggs and Stratton. Well, if 9 out of 10 lawnmowers you see has a Briggs and Stratton stuck on it, they don't need to compete with another company to make a better mower, to make a better motor. So they can make their motors cheaper and cheaper and cheaper. The other reason that they've been sent out of the United States, of course, is, you know, pure economics, labor costs, things like that, have sent industries out of here. I come from Youngstown, Ohio. Used to be, along with Pittsburgh, you know, the steel capital of the world.
Right.
You can't find a steel mill running in Youngstown, Ohio anymore. Where's all the steel coming from? It's coming from the Yangtze Valley in China. They're importing more iron and steel into this country and iron and steel products than it's unbelievable. You go to buy a bench vise, nice old iron bench vise that used to have, you know, been forged in Pittsburgh or Detroit, and where is it from? It's from China. Why the media doesn't focus on this? I don't know. It passes under their radar screen somehow.
They're part of it. Part of it.
It could be. I mean, they're certainly they're part of the corporate, the solid corporate entity that you're not going to offend your advertisers and you're not going to offend your corporate bosses either. So sure, absolutely.
Yeah. I was reading. There was a big article this morning about Walmart. I forget whether it was in the. I think it was in the Wall Street Journal.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, Walmart. They pay their employees so little that the employees are eligible for food stamps and government welfare. Did you know that?
Yes, I did. Yep, and at that point is made shockingly clear in Barbara Ehrenreich's book, Nickel and Dimed, in which she tries to live on a Walmart salary, and she found out that she could do one of two things, feed or house herself, but not both, on a full-time Walmart salary. And that, of course, is criminal. If somebody working full-time, and I mean 40 hours a week, you know, morning to night, and can't both feed or house themselves both. I'm outraged by that as well. And it's one of the reasons why I wrote this this book, is I wanted to explain to people that, you know, if you get off that retail grid, you can actually live really, really well. And you don't have to feed monsters like Walmart with your money.
Yeah, and it's really a shame. It's really a shame that everything that you buy, I don't care whether it's a VHS tape recorder, a DVD player, a television, it's all made in China. Mm-hmm. Everything is made in China. And it is not repairable.
No. No, it isn't repairable.
Not repairable. You know, this country used to have a fantastic repair industry. When I was a kid, I used to work for a TV repair shop, and I learned how to fix TVs and radios. And back then, in the 50s, in the late 50s, a color TV set was a lot of money. I mean, they were like $300-$500.
Oh, sure.
And that was a lot of money back then.
Mm-hmm.
But very often, when they went on the blink, you could put a $3 tube in it, and it was good again.
Right.
And it would last another couple years.
Mm-hmm.
And then another tube would go out, and you could put another tube in it, and it was good again.
Mm-hmm.
Today, when that TV set fails, all you can do is throw it away. And that means that all of the silicon, all of the metal, all of the aluminum, all of the plastic, all of the glass, all of the workmanship is going to the dump.
That's right.
And that, in my opinion, is just absolutely obscene. That we're taking all of these precious things. You know, plastic is made out of oil.
Yes.
And if you have a plastic television set with a plastic cabinet, I mean, that used up a whole bunch of oil. And now you're going to throw it in the dump?
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Exactly. All right, hang on. When we come back, let's talk about some of the secondhand things you found that were really, really treasures. The name of the book is That Might Be Useful, Exploring America's Secondhand Culture, right after this.
I'm sure you've heard the saying, when you get to the end of your rope, tie a knot in it and hang on. Margie Garrison was at the end of her rope. At the young age of 28, she was told she would be in a wheelchair in about 5 years. And then, when she just couldn't go on any longer, she met a doctor who said to her, "Margie, arthritis is the easiest disease there is to cure." Now, can you imagine Margie's joy after 43 years and thousands of dollars of doctor bills and pain medications that didn't work? Learn the whole story online at healthstarproducts.com. That's HealthStarProducts.com. It's guaranteed or your money back, and you have a full year to decide. Look it up online for yourself at HealthStar, H-E-A-L-T-H, HealthStarProducts.com, and find out if what worked for Margie Garrison will work for you.
Welcome to Straight Talk with Dr. Barry Sears. Dr. Sears, there's a history of heart disease in my family. What can I do?
We know heart disease is now an inflammatory disease, not a disease of cholesterol. And therefore, the best way to reduce heart disease is to reduce inflammation. And the best way we have to do that on a long-term basis is take adequate levels of fish oils, rich in omega-3 fatty acids, refined to make sure there's no toxins. Again, fish oils like OmegaRX. This will be really your drug for the future to keep heart disease and the inflammation that comes with it under control.
The best way to add essential omega-3 fatty acids to your diet is by supplementing with Dr. Barry Sears' ultra-potent, ultra-clean, pharmaceutical-grade OmegaRX fish oil. To order your fish oil today, call 800-962-0123, 800-962-0123, or visit cleanfishoil.com. Call now for OmegaRX fish oil, 800-962-0123, or visit cleanfishoil.com.
All right, we're talking to Nate and Leslie, and the name of the book is That Might Be Useful, Exploring America's Secondhand Culture. When you say that you have been able to outfit you and your family with secondhand clothes, where do you buy them?
I buy a lot of clothes at yard sales. I buy clothes. One of the best places for clothing is either Goodwill or the Salvation Army, and most people think, oh, those things have been, you know, donated, they're worn out, and they absolutely are not. You can get practically brand new L.L. Bean clothing, brand name clothing. I got Levi blue jeans for $3.99. That if they were worn once or twice, that would have been the maximum. I buy new shoes because I believe that shoes tend to take a sort of a set to your feet, and I think you have to break in your own shoes. But that's my own personal preference. I think you could actually buy used shoes as well. We have a lot of fun shopping at those places, too, because we find unusual things you wouldn't expect to find. A Pakistani soccer shirt that my stepson Keith thinks is just the greatest thing, and just weird stuff that we find. You know the old saying, one man's trash is another man's treasure. Well, I think that applies to clothing or anything that you buy secondhand. It's all a matter of how you look at things and whether you can find value in what other people want to have wanted to throw away.
One of the things I tell people, and very often folks will find an old, maybe they'll find a business that's been closed for years. Maybe it was a bar and lounge.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it was a drugstore or what have you. And I tell them, if there's a jukebox in there, don't throw it away.
Right.
What a lot of people are not aware of is that these old jukeboxes, circa 1940, 1950, 1960, can bring as high as $5,000 and $7,000.
Oh, absolutely. The music collectibles business is a huge, huge market. And not only old jukeboxes, but old wind-up Victrolas, old Edison talking machines that use the wax cylinders.
Right.
These things are immensely collected, and some of them, the right machines, can go for many, many thousands of dollars. But that doesn't mean you can't have an old Victrola. You know, I have a wonderful old wind-up Victrola that we buy Tommy Dorsey and old records from the 40s and 30s and so on, and I picked it up for $150 at an auction, and it plays just as good as the one that you would spend $4,000 for that's highly collectible.
Right.
And we have a lot of fun buying these old records and listening to these old songs, and of course the kids think it's just absolutely amazing that you can play music on something you don't have to plug in. So there's lots of things that are amusing about the secondhand business, but sure, people need to be aware that a lot of the stuff that they find or stuff that's in their basements or in their grandmother's attic, do a little research. The Internet's a great place to do that kind of research and just find out what the stuff's worth before you let it go.
Yeah, very often people will let stuff go for next to nothing that is worth a fortune.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Absolute fortune.
And they don't know what it is that they have. And of course, people in the business rely upon those folks in order to make, you know, what they call a home run, or you know, make a big profit. But it doesn't have to be through somebody's not knowing what it is that they've found. For instance, I bought, or what it is they were selling, I bought a box of books at an auction for a dollar box lot. You know, they're selling a bunch of books, and they let them all go for a dollar a box, and you take your pick. And I grabbed a box that had a book in it I thought was interesting. So I thought, you know, for a buck, I got one book. The rest of them, I'll find somebody else who wants. But I decided, as I always do, to look through the books first. But tucked in the pages of one of the books was a ribbon for a poll watcher for Teddy Roosevelt's old Bull Moose Party.
Wow.
When he ran for president back after he'd been president, you know, and ran for re-election on the Bull Moose Party. It had a bull moose on it, and the old Progressive Party. And so I looked at that, and I said, somebody's going to want this. Some presidential memorabilia collector's going to want that. I put it up for auction, and it sold for $125. And probably they thought they got a deal on it, but well, I didn't pay anything for it.
Well, what's amazing is a lot of people, if you buy a box of books, you know, for a dollar,
mm-hmm.
very often in the old days, people used to hide money in books.
That's right. That's
so,
right.
So whatever you do, flip the pages of the books and see if any old bills come out.
Absolutely. That's the very first thing you should do. And old bills, and you just never know what people are going to tuck into old books. So, you know, it has the allure of a treasure hunt too. This kind of business. There's always something, you know, waiting around the corner that just might, you know, might make for a real find, if not a real good paycheck. And there are people who live this way. And it's the largest unregulated industry in the United States right now, secondhand culture. It's what I like about it is that it's completely unregulatable. How can you stop people from selling stuff in their front yard? You know, you just simply can't. They, you know, it's almost an underground culture, and it's purely buying and selling and trading, and it's the most American of enterprises. And it does me good to know that it thrives, and that this part of the American spirit is still going strong. And that's what I hope to celebrate with the book.
Well, once upon a time, there actually used to be in some towns where you could only have 3 yard sales a year.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if they still do that or not, but in some areas they had that deal. But then again, you could have a yard sale and then maybe a garage sale.
Right.
When we come back, let's talk about treasures to look for. The secondhand culture returns.
Okay, everyone needs a little legal help along the way. Here's a website with over 10,000 do-it-yourself legal forms for all sorts of state and federal needs. Buying or selling a car or boat, power of attorney. Writing a promissory note. Making a legal demand. Now you can log on and have over 10,000 legal forms right there at your fingertips. Just go to www.chuckcartershow.com. On the homepage, you'll find the link that will take you to over 10,000 legal forms. These forms are designed to help protect your rights and to save you time and money. Just visiting the site with over 10,000 legal forms is interesting and informative. Each form is prepared by attorneys and offered with a no-risk, 100% money-back guarantee. So when you need legal forms of any kind, go to www.chuckhardershow.com. That's chuckhardershow.com. Remember, www.chuckhardershow.com, where you can link up with over 10,000 legal forms online. Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom, the television show that America grew up watching. Now available on DVD. 20 episodes are yours for just $29.99. That's the money-saving price if you order online from RetroTelevision.com. RetroTelevision.com. Wild Kingdom, featuring Marlon Perkins and all the regular features that made this show a favorite family watching habit. Sorry, phone orders are not available at this low price of $29.99 for 20 episodes. Order this set now and get 3 episodes with famed primate researcher Diana Fossey from Gorillas in the Mist. Order from RetroTelevision.com or go to www.TalkStarRadio.com. Save 25% with the online offering Wild Kingdom from RetroTelevision.com and TalkStar Radio.
We are back with Nate and Leslie. Are you there? Hello there. We have Static and Crunchy, but no Nate and Leslie. Well, we hope we can get him back. All right. The name of the book is That Might Be Useful. That Might Be Useful, Exploring America's Secondhand Culture. And I guess one of the things that I wanted to talk to him about was some of the treasures you might look for. Now, I can tell you a few that I know of. Number one is old clocks. Now, whatever you do, if you buy an old clock, before you move it, take the pendulum off. Take the pendulum off. Because if you don't, it can damage the clock. Whether it's a grandfather clock or a mantle clock or a wall clock, take off the pendulum. But very often you can find mantle clocks, old clocks, wall clocks, grandfather clocks, and sometimes they are worth big bucks. Years ago, when I was a young man, I found a grandfather clock in a church store, you know, secondhand store. And I paid, I believe it was $85 for it. I was glad to have it. I wound up selling it for $2,000, $2,000. It was a very, very rare model. There's other things you can find that are, you know, really treasures. Look for exquisitely carved furniture. Furniture that has, you know, really beautiful lines to it. Stuff that is looks like it's been carved or hand-carved, you know, with the big carved legs and what have you. A number of things that used to be really, really worthwhile were student lamps, student desks, anything that looks appealing to the eye. You know, not just something that is real plain Jane. Oh, plain Jane table is fine. But if it's got, you know, really carved well and it's got character to it, you know, kind of like a Maltese Falcon, you're talking about something that might really be worth money. Years ago, people used to collect hand-carved figurines, even cuckoo clocks. Some of the cuckoo clocks years and years ago that were actually made in the Black Forest, you know, pre-World War II, some of them are worth some money. But then again, there are a number of books that you can find that will tell you what stuff is worth. Cobell's puts them out. There's a number of places where you can find out what an item is worth, what a collectible item is worth. A good place to look very often is eBay and see what they start bidding for. That'll give you some kind of a rough idea. But it's amazing some of the things that go for so cheap. And very often, when they have these farm auctions or estate auctions or what have you, or even the roadside auction or the garage sale, very often the people just want you to cart it away and get rid of it. Isn't that something? I'm Chuck Harder for the people. Glad to be with you on TalkStar. If you'd like to help us in our mission, your tax-deductible donation can be sent to For the People. That's For the People. P.O. Box 150. P.O. Box 150, Tampa, Florida. 33601. P.O. Box 150, Tampa, Florida, 33601. Thanks, everybody. God bless you and your family and our troops. And thanks, everybody, up and down the radio trail. God bless America.